Oh, good morning, Branchline. Good setting the mood, right? You could turn to Philippians chapter 2 if you got your Bible with you. Otherwise, it'll be up on the screen here. Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, 1st. There we go. Philippians chapter 2, verses 14 to 16 says this, do everything without complaining or arguing. Stop it, right? Verse 15, so that no one can criticize you, live clean and innocent lives as children of God, shining like bright lights in a world full of crooked and perverse people. Hold firmly to the word of life. Then on the day of Christ's return, I will be proud that I did not run the race in vain and that my work was not useless. Let's pray before we begin, church. Father, thank you for bringing us here this morning, for allowing us to enter into worship together, to sing songs about your love, your glory, how you're a good Father. And we just pray that you would open our eyes, our ears, and our hearts now to your word, how we can understand Scripture better so that we can live the type of lives that you want us to. And Father, we know that's a work of the Holy Spirit within us, so we just pray that you would be present, guiding us, and showing us the ways in which we can be those people that you want us to be. And we pray these things in Jesus' name, amen. Do everything without complaining or arguing. Who's got this one mastered? No? Oh, come on, church. Grumbling, bickering, whining, right? We all do it, okay? Let's just get that out here. And you do not have to be in a marriage to do this, do you, church? In fact, all you have to do is be around other people, and you will find ways to complain and argue, right? Now, bickering drives me nuts. Does it drive any of you nuts? Especially like my kids, right? So Noah and Lily, they're 9 and 6, and they bicker constantly in the house, right? No, that's not how you play with the Hot Wheels. No, that's my seat. No, I don't want to watch that TV show. Does this sound familiar to anyone? Right? Drives me nuts. Now, I don't mind if complaining and arguing happen every once in a while, but when I'm around and it's the norm, right? Oh, that drives me nuts. Because it doesn't help the situation, does it? Has bickering and complaining and arguing ever really, like, helped you solve a problem in a very clear way? Sometimes, okay. Depends on how we do it. Nudge, nudge, husband, isn't that right? John. I heard Cindy say yeah. We're not calling anyone out here. No. See, complaining and arguing, right? This thing is when we like to vent and feel better, right? Like sometimes it's just good when you're feeling frustrated to just let it out, right? Usually at the expense of the other person, and certainly to the expense of all the other people around you too, right? So if you've had parents and grandparents or kids that constantly bickered, you know what I'm talking about here today. So today, what we're going to do is we're just going to take that first verse, right? Verse 14, in everything, no complaining or arguing. I can't remember, what does it say? Do everything without complaining and arguing. And we're just going to take a very practical look at that for our relationships. And then next week, we're going to revisit these passages to take a look at verses 15 and 16 to really see what was going on in these passages. So let's look at complaining and arguing. And first thing we need to understand is, why do we do this, right? Why do we complain and argue? Well, the reason we complain and argue is because we all do things differently, don't we, church? We all have our own idea of the right way to do things, and we all act in ways that we think are best. So when we are in relationship with someone else or a group of people, it's going to be natural when you have to work closely with them that you are going to have differences where they act like a moron, right? Okay, I was expecting a bigger joke than that, but bigger laugh, okay. Apparently we're getting real here. Y'all been thinking other people are morons. We're like, ugh, how does he read my mind? But anyway, moving on, ADHD. We get upset, we get frustrated, right, when we work together with other people, and we begin to grumble in our own minds. And then we maybe express that to other people, right? And in our video this morning, the married couple had their differences, right? The right way to fold the towels, the right way to load the dishwasher, the right way to put toilet paper on the toilet paper roll. These are all personality differences and clashes that happen in our life, and that leads to frustration. But sometimes we deal with that frustration in a constructive way, right? Where we work together with other people and we solve it in a nice, healthy way. But a lot of times we get into what Paul is getting at here, where we enter into the destructive way of dealing with our frustrations. Where we express our frustration with grumbling, arguing, complaining, where it feels good, but it doesn't really accomplish anything. It doesn't help the situation. Where our own brains are telling us, oh, that person is so frustrating. I wish they would just shut up. Why are they so stupid? I will murder them and marry the pizza guy, right? And he will help me bury the body. Can it be a pizza girl for the guys in the room? Yeah, okay, anyway, moving on. Satan loves it when we get frustrated, and he loves to toy with the things that we do in our brains, where we think and feel, and then we express something destructive. And instead of being like Christ, and shining in a crooked world the way that Christ acts, we instead give in to our sinful nature. We start acting in ways that don't reflect the love and unity that Paul has been talking about so far in the book of Philippians, right? And that's usually the time when you engage in that level of destruction in your relationships that you stop listening to each other. And then you just start bickering about everything, and then it's just lobbing grenades at each other, and pretty soon your relationship falters and deteriorates. So today, I want to walk through that healthy, constructive way. What do you do when you feel frustrated with someone else? And instead of choosing the destructive path, I want to choose the path that gives life. So the first thing we do when you feel frustrated is you need to pick your battles, church. Pick your battles. When we get frustrated because someone is doing something wrong in our own eyes, I think we need to take a second and be like, is this a big deal? Right? We need to start thinking a little bit about, what is this thing that is frustrating me? Sure, there are issues that are worth arguing about, but there are a lot of issues that are not worth it. Right, church? Maybe we have differences of opinion in that, right? About loading the dishwasher or not. But in the end, we can all agree that there are some things that are not worth arguing about. Take, for instance, loading the dishwasher. Sure, you should have a conversation with other people in your household about how to do that, but is it worth harboring bitterness over? Is it worth grumbling about? Is it worth arguing about it over and over again? You see, us humans, sometimes we lose focus and we make mountains out of molehills, right? The little things become the big things. And within that framework, we lose the commands of the Bible in how we are to deal with each other. Take, for instance, Colossians 3, verses 12 to 15. It says, since God chose you to be the holy people he loves, you must clothe yourselves with truth and make sure everyone obeys that truth, right? No, he says, clothe yourselves with tenderhearted mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, and church, patience. Now the next line, make allowance for each other's faults and forgive anyone who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. Above all, clothe yourselves with love, which binds us all together in perfect harmony. And let the peace that comes from Christ rule in your hearts. For as members of one body, you are called to live in peace and always be thankful. Does complaining and arguing bring about peace, love, patience, church? And the art of picking your battles is the art of knowing when you need to talk to someone about something and when you need to give an allowance for something. That's the reason that Paul wrote these words. It's because when humans live together, we have to accept things about each other, don't we? Some of the stuff that really drives us nuts even. Because if we just nitpick each other, then our relationships with that community are not going to be the clothing ourselves like Paul talks about in Colossians 3. Paul even explicitly says in Romans 14:1, accept other believers who are weak in faith and don't argue with them about what they think is right or wrong. Pretty explicit right there, right, church? there's an allowance made, especially for people who are not quite yet mature enough to understand what you understand, right? Okay, that was a joke. I know I'm hitting home when no one laughs at those, right? So before you go and address your frustration with someone else, first, figure out if it's worth the fight, worth the battle, or if it's just something to accept about the other person. Because you don't want to be a nitpicker or grumble about everything, right, church? Okay, second, I want you guys to be creators. Be a creator. When it comes to church and being a part of a church community, right? We're just talking big church, right? Stepping aside from grumbling and arguing. But now we're just talking about when you come to church, sometimes there's a lot of things that you come here in order to consume, right? Sunday mornings is a great example. Most Sundays we come here and you consume a good worship set, right? You sing along. Oh, these are the songs I like, right? And then you are also consuming sort of a teaching, right, that I've been theoretically working on all week to give you. They're laughing because they know when I send it out. But we are together, and the idea is that we get something from this time together, right? Like, we would not come to church unless we get something from that church. And that's normal, right? And even people who stop feeling like they get something from a church, then they question, why am I here? Why am I going, right? It's this natural human thing we do. We think about our own desires, our own wants, our own needs, and if those aren't being met, we can look elsewhere to meet them. But in a church community, there's this maturing step that needs to happen, and that's where we move from being a consumer to being a creator. That church no longer just becomes about what we get from it, but it also becomes about what we are called to create and give to others. The way that God has transformed us, we give out of that. We create something along with God. This is one of those steps of maturity. When you become a disciple of Jesus, you move from receiving and consuming to giving back, to helping build up the community into what it should be. You still get things, don't get me wrong, church, but it's about giving more. And to give back, to help build up the church community into what it should be, church needs to no longer be about what you necessarily get, but how can you help create something for other people? See, the focus of a consumer is all about their desires and wants. And in our relationships, when we get frustrated, we can quickly fall into that consumerist mindset, right? What do I want here? And how can I get the other person to do it that way? And we focus on what we want. We want worship a certain way. We want towels folded a certain way. We want the preacher who has the arm tattoos and doesn't do dad jokes. Sorry, church. I saw some shirts where, like, you can, they're like sleeves of tattoos. Maybe I could get some of those if that's what you really want, right? Okay. I'm going to, like, okay. Anyway, moving on. I am all over the place this morning. Back to creating. The focus of a creator is about, what are we going to produce here? What can I give? How can I contribute? And when you're frustrated, ask yourself, do you want to go to the other person as a consumer, where you're just worried about what you get from them? Or do you want to be a creator, someone who is there to create something with that other person? So church, if you decided this is a battle that I think we need to actually like work on together, if it's a large enough issue to address with another person, then don't go to them just expecting them to conform to what you want. Be a creator with them. And specifically, that you would create an interaction that honors, respects, and shows them love. That's that clothing that Paul says to put on. That's what you want to create when you go to someone with an issue. You see a problem, but you see the other person as a teammate, someone who you can work together with to create a solution to solve it. And that's what creates deeper relationships. That's what creates communities of love and joy. That's what creates interactions that show God's love, and not just your annoyance with things. Because church, if you just go in guns blazing, right, arguing, complaining, you're not creating anything but a mess. A type of community and relationship that is selfish. But if you can head in with the same attitude of Jesus, something we've been talking about as we studied Philippians, then you'll be adopting what Paul is talking about. When he said, don't be selfish, don't try to impress others, be humble, think of others as better than yourselves. Don't look out for your own interests, he says, but the interests of others. Do you guys remember when we studied that earlier in chapter 2? Okay, cool. Now Paul's telling us how to live it out. Be a creator, not just a consumer after your own interests. So church, you've examined your heart, you figured it's a big enough battle, you got to address it, right? And now you've set your mind right so that you're going to be a creator of a conversation that builds, creates, shows love, respect, and honors the other person as a team. Now what? Church, you got to go directly to the person. Yes, I know it's awkward, right? But that's what you got to do. See, part of this grumbling and complaining and arguing is that when people get frustrated, we don't always think to go directly to the person that we're frustrated with, right? No, what do, church? We go and complain to someone else, right? Kristen, were you there last Sunday when the pastor went into like a 15-minute word study in the middle of the sermon? Oh my God, it was so boring, I fell asleep. Hitting too close to home? It's okay if you fell asleep. Like, there was a bunch of people asleep last Sunday. I can see you. But it's okay. It was boring. I'm glad you got a good nap. But it was good info. Maybe go back and listen to it. But when we complain, sometimes we go to other people. It's kind of this reflex we do, right? Because it's easier and safer to express your frustrations to other people who you know are going to agree with you than it is to actually go to the person causing frustration and actually have a very deep talk with them about it, right? Yeah, we seek validation by other people in what they say. But this reflex creates gossip in our communities. Gossip does not resolve the frustration, it just spreads it further. And if you want to resolve the frustration, you have to go directly to the person causing the frustration with a heart to create that loving interaction and a solution to it. Okay, fourth, you got to be the emptier person. Be the emptier person. See, this is the point where the gospel actually gets put into action. Right? The way that Jesus acts is the way that we are supposed to act. You see, our society tells us, be the bigger person in conflicts, which isn't a terrible phrase, but I like emptier person in a conflict. Earlier in Philippians chapter 2, Paul broke out into a hymn, a song. And in the middle of the song, he stated that Jesus, who was the same form of God, gave up his divine privileges to come down to the earth. In the Greek, it says Jesus emptied himself. And he emptied himself in order to become the suffering slave who would take on the sins of the world and die on the cross. This is the self-sacrificial, agape love that reflects the character of God. And within that emptying of himself, Jesus gave us a model for letting go of complaining and arguing. If you are frustrated with someone else, you may be 100% correct in the way that you do things. Okay, church? If you're frustrated with someone else, you may be 100% correct. You may be perfectly knowledgeable. You may have every right to approach that person with the goal of helping them understand that you are right. This is usually the heart of someone setting out to argue or complain, right? But the divine grace given to us by Jesus shows us that sometimes the right thing to do is actually empty ourselves, even if we are right. To take on the deficiencies of others, the weaknesses of others, the failing of others in relationship with them. As you work with the other person, understand that they are a human being with limitations. And sometimes the solution to a problem isn't getting them to do the right thing, but it's actually about emptying yourself. Emptying your privileges, emptying your desires. And embracing them as a human, as Jesus has embraced you in your sinfulness. When I say be the emptier person, what I mean is that sometimes the best solution is taking on something that you know isn't right in order to love that other person. So yes, you may be 100% correct in the way to load the dishwasher, but maybe loading it 90% correct is an okay solution, right, church? And yes, you may be correct that someone else's sin is causing you frustration and they should not be sinning. But maybe loving and bearing with them in their sinfulness reflects exactly what Jesus does for you in loving and bearing your sins. Don't get me wrong, in a perfect world, everyone does what you know to be best, right? Why can't those politicians just see what I see? Why can't that pastor just read this the way I read it? Talking as Christian now. Why can't my husband do this the right way, right? And you deserve a good life free from frustrations, church. You deserve not to have to deal with frustrations or the problems or sins of other people. Too bad. Entering into deep community and deep relationships with other people means that you enter into relationships with broken people. You enter into relationships with people who don't do things the right way, and you may have to give up things in order to build a relationship with those people, even if they don't deserve it. And this is exactly the type of emptying that Jesus did for you. Now, here, you approach the other person, you've emptied yourself, and I want you guys to know that compromise is the tool of emptying. Compromise is the tool of emptying. When you go and discuss the problem with someone, even if you're 100% correct, try and find a compromise. Maybe you need to meet them halfway if they don't see your way as the correct way. Where you can give up, empty yourself some of the things that you are owed or that you think are right, in order to extend grace, mercy, and forgiveness to others. Compromise is the art of saying, I will empty myself if it means that we can grow closer together. And there is something divinely loving about approaching solutions with that in mind. Kristen's not here. I accidentally stole her car keys this morning on the way out, so she would have been here. I told her I was mentioning her. So sometimes Kristen, on Saturdays, will take all three of our children with her in order to give me a few hours to finish my sermon. Lovely woman, guys. You should really, give her a thumbs up. Perhaps it's more than sometimes, right? That was a joke. It's not right, and it's not fair that Kristen has to use Saturdays to watch the kids because I did not finish my work before the weekend. Is that fair to her? No. Is that frustrating to her? The Minnesotan, you betcha, right? Yeah. But I'm always in awe of that kind of love when she says, I'll take the kids, take a few hours, finish your sermon. Right? And I think to myself, she would do that for me, even when really what I deserve is to get yelled at, right? When I get told, well, you can work on the sermon at 9 o'clock after the kids are in bed, right? That's what I deserve. And then, because she empties herself in that moment, then I can try and turn around on Sunday and empty myself and take the kids out by myself. So she can get a few hours to herself. And there's this sort of ebb and flow to a healthy relationship, right? Where sometimes they empty, sometimes you empty. You're both humble, putting each other's interests above your own. And in doing that for each other, we start to love each other as God first loved us. That is the art of compromise, of being in relationship with others who give of themselves even when it's not right or fair. And that's exactly what Jesus shows us by emptying himself, dying on a cross, in order to bring us closer because we couldn't do things right. So you've talked to the person directly. You've tried to empty yourself. You try to meet them in the middle. You've adopted a mindset to work with them and create a good solution. Awesome, church. Great. What happens if they don't respond in kind? Yeah. Then we bust out the arguing and complaining, right? Bust out that Bible. Let me tell you something. Right? Sorry, I don't know why I did that. I apologize. I'm not a Bible thumping. Anyway, moving on. What do you do when you try over and over and over again and the issue is really big? Well, let me just give you permission that sometimes boundaries are needed, church. Healthy boundaries can sometimes be needed. Now look, I'd love it if every single person at Branchline emptied themselves, if every single person approached this humbly, if every single person worked at this loving together in unity. I'd love it if we all could do that. But I'm a realist, and I met some of you, right? I mean that in a loving way, right? And I know that when Paul is writing in this letter, he's envisioning a community that has sold all their possessions. They've moved in together. They literally have to live together in the same house. And that's a lot different than here on Sunday morning, isn't it, church? The depth of relationships that Paul is writing about is not the same depth of relationships that we all have here. You got some of it, I hope. I hope you got a few of those type of level of relationships. But on Sunday morning, we're kind of gathering together to try to do what we do in America when it comes to church. And that I absolutely hope that as we sort of organize and run our church, right, that we would be exhibiting this level of unity, this level of emptying ourselves, this level of not complaining and organizing. But I also recognize that there are personality conflicts here at the church. And sometimes it's okay to have a boundary with those people. You guys, I'm giving you permission in that. My hope is that you don't need to do that, but I know it's hard when we have different people with different levels of maturity to actually do that type of deep, loving relationship with each other. So what's a good boundary? Let's say there's someone at church who really drives you bananas when you serve alongside them or you're around them, and you approach them to address the situation, but because there's not a lot, like a strong relationship, or there's not that level of maturity that you both need, you've met with stonewalling, or you or them decide that you're wrong, or they're wrong, or you don't want to compromise, right? And you feel like in going to God, he's not asking you to empty yourself further and take on something that you can bear. Then it's okay to set a boundary that maybe you don't serve with that person or join a small group with them. And this is the same type of boundary that God gives us in our marriages when someone else is abusive or cheats or things like that, right? You can set a healthy boundary because humans sometimes don't always set out to do this whole loving relationship with each other. Now, I'm hoping these boundaries are extremely rare at Branchline. I'm hoping we all adopt this level of maturity. But I also know we're all human. We're at different levels. And sometimes it can be necessary to set a boundary. And in those cases, I want you to be polite with each other. I don't want you to gossip about the other person. And I don't want you to feel like they can't be here at this church, right? The New Testament church kind of has quite a few passages about this type of boundary. But I don't want us to feel like, oh, we're only here with the people who agree with us, who act the right way or behave the right way. What I'm trying to create here and lead us into as a community is one where we deal with our differences in very loving ways. But we can also acknowledge those differences, right? Is everyone here with me on that? Or do you all just want to like believe what I believe and act how I say you act? Does that sound fun? No, because we'd all be in a hippie commune. How many of you want to do that, right? Okay, that was a joke. Moving on. You set a boundary, then it's the pastor's problem, right? Just, you know, hey, pastor, this person's not acting right. Okay, I'll deal with it. But even if there are a few people like that who you have to have boundaries with, doesn't mean they're excluded from the community. And it could certainly mean that there are other people at the church who can work with them on teams and in small groups. We need to make a place for people, even if they're maybe not quite as mature as you want them to be in these things. And church, that leads us into communion. Do you guys know what communion is all about? It's actually how we remember what Jesus has done for us. We come to this communion table remembering Jesus' act of sacrifice on the cross, his act of emptying himself to come to earth, to die for our sins when he didn't have to, and to create sort of a divine compromise where he would do something that we could not do for ourselves so that we could be in right relationship with God. We all come around this table with differences. Differences that cause us to grumble and complain and argue with each other. But when we come to this table, we got to know that those differences don't exclude anyone. That's actually the beauty of Jesus' sacrifice, is that everyone's invited to the table. And when we come to the table, we confess our differences. We confess how we don't do right things. We confess our sins of selfishness, pride, greed, gossip, gluttony. And we confess those things that make us fall short of doing things how we're supposed to be doing them. Right, church? The right way. But this table represents and reminds us that forgiveness and compromise is God's way of doing things in this world. We eat this bread and we drink this cup because we need to remember what Jesus did and how our sins are forgiven and that God lives with our differences. We consume these things to reflect and remember what Jesus created within us, something we could not do for ourselves. So we kind of have a little rhythm with our communion table. And what we're going to do is we're going to read our passage that reflects on this sacrifice, what Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians. And then when we're done reading that passage, we're going to play two songs over the speakers. And I just want you, during the first song, to just sit and reflect. Confess to God all those ways in which we don't do it the right way, right? How we don't live up to the way that we should be. And how grateful we are that he made a way for us. That he loved us. That he found the way for us to be in right relationship with him. And then, when you feel like you've confessed enough and feel like you're thankful enough, then come forward and we're going to have two people serving. The grape juice and bread, and then eat and drink to remember. And let's read what Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 to 26. And he says this, "For I pass on to you what I received from the Lord himself. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took some bread and gave thanks to God for it. Then he broke it in pieces and said, 'This is my body, which is given for you. Do this to remember me.' And in the same way, he took the cup of wine after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant between God and his people, in agreement confirmed with my blood. Do this to remember me as often as you drink it. For every time you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death until he comes again. The Lord's death that brought you life. The Lord's death that gives you the image of how you are supposed to be with others in community.'" And so as we listen to the song, take time, reflect, pray, and when you're ready, come forward and receive.